This year, Japanese television broadcasting celebrates its 60th anniversary. Soon after TV became available in Japan, it grew into a focal point of family life. Today, just about every household has a TV or even several. Many Japanese even have their own personal TV. They really do love television. TV can be watched not only on dedicated sets, but also on mobile phones, car navigation systems, and other devices. And did you know that the very first cathode ray tube TV was made in Japan? Japanese TV technology has been setting the pace ever since. And today, new televisions continue to be developed. Ones that are higher definition, 3D, internet connected, and more. On this edition of Begin Japanology, our theme is television. We'll trace Japan's 60 years of broadcasting history, look at the viewing habits of TV-loving Japan, and take a peek at the latest developments in TV technology.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakat. Behind me here you'll see NHK, which is of course the network that broadcasts this program. Television, though we all take it for granted these days, is a medium which gives us access to events that are happening all over the world and has brought all kinds of historic moments into all of our living rooms. According to studies by NHK, the average Japanese watches something like 3.5 hours of television every day, which for a country which is famous for being a nation of workaholics is perhaps a slightly surprising figure. Japan has also been in the forefront of developing high-tech televisions and has been a dominant player in the global television market. Let's start off today with a look at the relationship between television and the Japanese.
If we look at the global television landscape, the US is led by private sector broadcasters, and much of Europe by public sector ones. Japan followed a path somewhere in between. Along with public broadcaster NHK, there are many commercial broadcasters competing in the TV market. Everyone in Japan with television reception must have a broadcast receiving contract with NHK and pay a receiving fee. In contrast, commercial broadcasters are funded by advertising revenue. Viewers pay for the programming indirectly when they buy advertised products. What kind of programming fills the TV airwaves in Japan? These are the weekday TV listings for Tokyo in a newspaper. Most stations offer programs around the clock. Breaking down the lineup by category, around half of the 200 programs are variety shows. Entertainment programming dominates. What do people in Japan enjoy about TV?
Well, television is just about the only way to get new information in my daily life, especially as I live in the country.
For me, it's just much easier to get information from TV rather than reading a newspaper, I suppose. I watch information programs in the morning and dramas at night.
I let my kids watch TV while I get the housework done, and I just leave it on in the background most of the time. I'd say it's a part of our life.
How many hours of TV do the Japanese watch on average? This data shows the weekly TV watching habits of 5 countries. Japan watches 17.6 hours a week, the most of the 5. And how exactly do people watch TV? Let's look at 3 TV-watching households. The Tsubaraokas, a family of 3. Mrs. Wakamatsu and her 2 children. And Mr. and Mrs. Yamamuro. In the rooms where these homes have TVs, cameras are set up to record a 24-hour period. Today, the Yamamuro household is first to switch on their TV. It's 3 a.m., still pitch dark outside. When the newspaper comes, Mr. Yamamura reads it while watching the TV news. Here are the wakamatsus. One child turns on the TV at 5 a.m. The children are using the television to play video games. In the living room, broadcasting has to compete with video games. Meanwhile, the Tsuburaoka's first program of the day is a children's show. It's their usual strategy for waking their child up. Turn on his favorite cartoon. In Japan, TV is part of the morning routine of many families. They watch TV while eating breakfast. After Mr. Yamamura goes out, Mrs. Yamamura switches off the TV and starts cleaning the house. Mrs. Wakamatsu keeps one eye on the TV as she hangs up the laundry. And Mrs. Tsuburaoka leaves the TV on while she cleans. After house cleaning, it's time for a cooking show. She gets some tips for the evening meal. It's now early afternoon. Mrs. Wakamatsu watches a Korean drama while eating lunch. For the past 10 years, Korean dramas have been very popular in Japan, especially among women. The 3-hour-plus Korean drama finally ends. Dinner time. At the Tsuburaoka's, the TV stays off during the meal. After dinner, the family watches a science program. Over at the Yamamuro's, they are enjoying a quiz show.
Capitals of prefectures that don't face the sea.
Otsu in Shiga.
And in Yamanashi?
Corfu.
The quiz show generates conversation between husband and wife. The total amount of TV time was 7 hours 30 minutes at the Wakamatsu's, 9 hours at the Yamamuro's, and 10 hours at the Tsuburaoka's. That gives us an idea of just how much the Japanese love TV.
Now that's what I call TV addiction. I'm now in a showroom for kitchen and bathroom appliances. Not the sort of place you'd normally go to find a television, but that's what we are going to find. Hello. Now, I hear you have some special TVs here. Can you lead me to them, please?
Of course, just over here. This is a television that goes in your bathroom.
Aha! It's a TV made especially for the bathroom. It's got holes here for the speakers. So what happens if water gets in here?
It's a waterproof model, so water won't damage it.
Is there a lot of demand for televisions in the bathroom?
Yes, there is. About 40% of our customers say they'd like one.
Really? Do you get any feedback from people about what kind of shows they like to watch in the bath?
Many people watch sporting events, which can be quite long, so they keep watching them in the bath. And some customers say their children don't like to take a bath, but with the bathroom TV, they're happy to get into the tub.
Well, thank you very much. Well, you've seen the state of the art of TV in Japan. Let's go back and look at the evolution now.
TV broadcasting began in Japan in 1953, 60 years ago. That was 8 years after the end of the Second World War, which had left the country in ruins. Japan was still in the middle of rebuilding. In February of that year, NHK began television broadcasting. Reception was available only in and around Tokyo. On the first day, fewer than 900 households had TV broadcast receiving contracts. 6 months later, commercial TV broadcasting began. But at first, TV sets were slow to catch on. The least expensive TV sets cost 170,000 yen, at a time when a college graduate's starting monthly pay averaged 8,000 yen. So street corner TVs appeared. Broadcasters started placing TVs in department stores, stations, and parks to encourage the spread of TV viewing. Sumo, pro wrestling, and baseball were broadcast live. People watching television for the very first time were glued to the screen. At the start of TV broadcasting, video recording machinery did not exist, so programming centered on live broadcasts of sport and theater. Dramas and variety shows were also all broadcast live. Later on, with Japan experiencing rapid economic growth and the price of TV sets dropping, television viewing boomed. In 1957, many local stations opened and TV coverage spread nationwide. The TV set, along with the electric washing machine and the refrigerator, became one of the three sacred treasures of the new era. Appliances coveted by consumers that symbolized prosperity. In 1958, Tokyo Tower was completed, a broadcasting tower for radio and television. Now the TV era began in earnest. That year, the number of broadcast receiving contracts topped 1 million. Reflecting the upbeat mood of the times, variety and comedy shows were all the rage. In 1959 came an event of great significance for the spread of TV, the wedding parade of the Crown Prince. 100 TV cameras from various stations lined the 9-kilometer route from the Imperial Palace to the residence of the Crown Prince, giving unprecedented TV coverage of the 50-minute parade. Many people bought television sets in order to watch. 500,000 people lined the parade route, but 15 million watched on TV. Eventually, almost every household had a television. The living room TV set became a much-loved focal point of Japanese family life. Color TV broadcasting began in 1960. And 4 years later, a big event led to widespread adoption of color TV sets. The Tokyo Olympic Games. For the Olympics, Japanese engineers succeeded in setting up the world's first live satellite relay. The combined rating for the opening ceremony on all TV stations was a stunning 84.7%. As the years went by, sport, drama, music, quiz, and documentary programming added diversity to the television lineup. TV developed as a medium for presenting current affairs, but it also became a tool for enriching everyday life. Electronics makers poured resources into TV development, producing sets with ever-improving features. Higher picture quality, greater reliability, and lower cost allowed Japanese TV sets to conquer the world market. Japan's success even led to trade friction with other countries. In the 1980s came broadcasting satellite TV services. In the 1990s, communication satellite TV started. With the spread of satellite TV, the number of channels available multiplied. As programs became more diverse and everyone had their own favorite shows, the era of one TV per person arrived. TV later became viewable even on mobile phones and car navigation devices. In this way, TV evolved from a family activity to an individual one.
I'm in the NHK Museum of Broadcasting, where they have all kinds of television sets going back to even before broadcasting started in this country. The most primitive one they have here is this, which was actually made in 1931, but imported from England for the purpose of study. It's called the televisor, and it works on a kind of flipbook animation principle. You can see there's a disc inside here, and it has 30 holes cut into it in a kind of vortex formation. And as the disc rotates, The image from the light source behind the disc is projected through this lens here on the right-hand side. Apparently it wasn't very bright, though, because they were using a red neon lamp. Now, after that, in 1939, we get this machine here. They were planning to hold the Olympic Games here in Tokyo in 1940. That never happened for obvious reasons. But this machine was created in order for people to be able to see the games. Now, you'll see here there's a cathode ray tube inside the machine, but because it's so big, it has to be vertical. And that means that there's the screen of the television is on the top of the machine, and it's reflected through this mirror on the inside of the lid. This never actually made it onto the market, of course. Finally, in 1952, we get this, just 1 year before broadcasting starts in Japan. This is a prototype, and next we're going to meet the man who created it and is regarded as the father of Japanese television.
A Japanese character is displayed on a cathode ray tube. This was the world's first television image. The achievement was the work of the Japanese engineer Kenjiro Takayanagi. Takayanagi was an instructor at a technical school in Hamamatsu. He started doing research into television before the Second World War. His work was inspired by a French magazine he happened to see in a bookstore. It had an image of a woman being transmitted along with sound over radio, and the caption read, "Télévision," which literally means far-seeing. Takayanagi was a fan of kabuki theater. He thought to himself that if television really existed, people all over Japan could watch kabuki in their own homes. In 1924, Takayanagi began to tackle the television challenge. At the time, research into television was going on across the world, but elsewhere the focus was on mechanical devices based on the flipbook principle. This approach could not display fluid human movement. Takayanagi decided a totally different, fully electronic TV system was needed. He explored a type of vacuum tube used in physics experiments called a cathode ray tube, or CRT for short. These tubes emit light when hit by an electron beam. He reasoned that these light emissions could be arranged to form an image. In 1926, Takayanagi was the first person in the world to successfully display an image on a CRT. But there were problems with the system. It had only 40 scan lines. And in order to deliver clear images, it was necessary to develop a special camera. So Takayanagi got straight down to work developing this TV camera on his own. He continued this research for 8 years, but was not able to get a clear image. Meanwhile, experimental broadcasts were being conducted in other countries. Takayanagi realized that a lone researcher could only do so much. So he assembled a team of about 20 people, including experts in electronic components, optical lenses, and glass processing. By then, it had become the norm to create project teams to carry out research and development. In 1935, the team finally completed Japan's first TV camera. A TV system with 220 scan lines was achieved, clearly displaying an image of Takayanagi and his team members. Takayanagi's success became big news in Japan. He was visited by a researcher from NHK, which was aiming to begin television broadcasting. The 1940 Olympics were due to be held in Tokyo, and a government project was launched to broadcast them using television. Takayanagi and his team moved to Tokyo to fulfill their dream of TV broadcasting. But by then, Japan was heading down the road to war. The Olympics plan was abandoned. And the development team was disbanded. Takenagi was assigned by the Navy to the development of radar. And the war ended. Tokyo had been reduced to ash and rubble. Takenagi was convinced that Japan needed new industries to recover, and it was his mission to make television one of them. But the US occupation authorities opposed this, fearing that TV research could contribute to the development of electromagnetic weaponry. Takenagi lost his job, and his long-held dream of TV broadcasting seemed to be Takenagi immediately called together several electronics manufacturers. He established a television association that crossed corporate boundaries. In order for televisions to become commonplace, TV sets would have to be small with a clear picture. The association pooled its efforts to develop such a set. In February 1953, the dream of TV broadcasting became a reality. 30 years had passed since Takenagi first began his research. The first program ever broadcast was Takenagi's favorite, Kabuki. The dream that had guided Takenagi's lifetime pursuit had come true at last.
All these television sets behind me here followed on in the wake of that original set created by Mr. Takenagi all those years ago. And as I'm sure many people are aware, television manufacture is an industry in which Japan led the world for many years. Not only the TV sets themselves, but also the television cameras used by broadcasters all over the world are mainly made in Japan. We've got quite an array of them here, going all the way back to the 1950s, when you had to have those multiple lenses because you couldn't zoom back then, up to some quite recent models. And this is the kind of most recent. This is a high-definition camera, and it just goes with you on location very easily. And Japanese television still continues to evolve. Let's take a look.
This is an electronic shop in Tokyo. 300 different models of television are on sale. Let's take a look at some of the latest TVs.
This is a 4K TV, the hottest thing these days. It has four times the resolution of current HD broadcasting.
Conventional HD TVs have 2 million pixels. But 4K TVs have 8 million. They reproduce images in finer detail, giving viewers an even better picture to enjoy. This TV is equipped with a time shift function. It allows you to view TV programs that were previously broadcast, and it can record up to 15 complete days of programming on 6 channels. So you never have to worry about missing a show. And if you turn on the TV and find yourself in the middle of a program, just press a button and you can watch from the start. Further advances are in the pipeline. This is the NHK Science and Technology Research Laboratories. Here, research is being carried out on the TV of the future.
This is called Super High Vision. It's an ultra-high-definition TV system with 16 times as many pixels as current HD TV.
4,000 scanning lines provide the ultimate immersive viewing experience. It's as if you're pulled into the image. Special cameras for this system are being developed. The hope is to begin broadcasting in Super High Vision by 2020. This is integral 3D TV. You can see the 3D effect without wearing any special glasses.
The key feature of this TV is that there is a lens array composed of tiny lenses in front of the high-definition display.
When you look at this doll through the lens array, each lens contains an image of the doll. Look closely, and you'll notice that the doll's face appears slightly different in each lens. In the lenses on the right, the entire face can be seen. But towards the left, the amount of face visible becomes progressively narrower. This is the key to the integral 3D viewing effect. First, a camera shoots the subject through a lens array. Then the image is projected. And when it's seen through another lens array, it appears 3D to the viewer. This technique allows the image to appear 3D from any angle without the use of glasses. New forms of TV broadcasting that make use of the internet are also being developed. This system is called hybrid cast. It enables interactive viewing that links a TV up to tablets and smartphones.
Using hybrid cast, as you watch a program being broadcast, you can call up a map related to that program on your device. Do you see this map? If you go like this, as you can see, you bring the map up on the TV screen. And using the tablet interface, you can download, via the internet, previously broadcast programs related to the one you are currently watching.
Research into new possibilities for TV is moving forward every day.
Well, widescreen TVs are something we all take for granted these days, and the quality of the images that we see on them is getting so clear that those old VHS tapes that clutter up our houses look positively antediluvian these days. At the same time, I, for one, am happy to sit in front of my laptop watching old music clips on YouTube. So where does television go from here? Your guess is as good as mine, but one thing's for certain, and that is that, obvious though it may seem, we, in our profession, have to keep producing top-quality programming. And with that, I'll see you again next time.
Lake Biwa, Japan's largest and the third oldest lake in the world. Its sacred waters have nurtured unique delicacies and beautiful freshwater pearls. It's helped to shape the Japanese view of nature.